War can bring out the worst in humanity, but also the best. When their survival is at stake, humans can band together to achieve incredible things. Regular people can become heroes. Such was the case with the Coastal Picket Force, or the Corsair Fleet, in the Second World War, a group of civilian sailors who rolled up their sleeves to protect the US coast. This is their story. As with most things military, the structure of the US Navy during the Second World War was a little confusing. There was the Navy, the Marine Corps, and the Coast Guard, and prior to 1941, the Coast Guard was under the jurisdiction of the US Treasury Department. In June 1939, before the war had started, the Coast Guard formed the Coast Guard Reserve under an act of the same name. By early 1941, the Coast Guard Reserve boasted 7,000 to 8,000 civilian volunteers and 2,000 to 3,000 boats responsible for ensuring boating safety regulations were being followed and supporting the Coast Guard. In February, Congress split the Coast Guard Reserve into two sub-organizations: the US Coast Guard Auxiliary, composed of civilians, and the US Coast Guard Reserve, composed of reservists with military responsibilities. In this time of war, the jurisdiction of the Coast Guard Auxiliary and the Reserve fell to the US Department of the Navy. On the 7th of December 1941, the Japanese bombed Pearl Harbor. Following that, German U-boats started stalking American ships along the East Coast and in the Gulf of Mexico. For them, it was American hunting season. In March 1942 alone, they sank 70 American merchant ships in that strip of coast, and from mid-January to late June 1942, a total of 26 American ships had gone down, totaling over 1.25 million gross registered tons. As it stood early in 1942, the Coast Guard was unable to answer the U-boat threat, so one civilian stepped up. Alfred Stanford, the Commodore of the Cruising Club of America, had been trying to convince Admiral Ernest J. King, Chief of Naval Operations, to let private boats and their owners assist in naval matters off the East Coast since mid-1941. But it wasn't until May 1942 that Admiral King agreed. During the interim, the public had caught wind of the idea and its popularity grew. American sailors, yachtsmen, and fishermen wanted to step up and do their part. Stanford himself had rallied 70 yachts and 100 smaller vessels to the cause. With the Admiral's thumbs up, the Coastal Picket Patrol was formed, administered by the Coast Guard Auxiliary originally. The Auxiliary, however, a civilian organization, proved unable to effectively manage the Coastal Picket Patrol, or as it came to be known, the Corsair Fleet. So Admiral King put it under the direct control of the Coast Guard proper. As such, the Corsair Fleet was given battleship grey paint jobs and USCG number designations. Some vessels were also equipped with radios, sonar equipment, 50 caliber machine guns, 20 millimeter guns, and 300 pound depth charges with which they could use to sink German subs. For a fun fact, among the volunteers was the novelist Ernest Hemingway, author of The Old Man and the Sea, among many other classics. He served aboard his 38-foot fishing boat, Pilar, patrolling the Florida Straits with a Tommy gun and some grenades on hand. Hemingway was a recognizable face the American people could get behind. The Coast Guard organized the Corsair Fleet into six groups: Northern, Narragansett, New York, Delaware, Chesapeake, and Southern. The fleet's task was to patrol the coast for enemy submarines and assist in rescue operations. If they had their guns, they were permitted to engage the enemy too. Often, the vessel's owners remained on their boats, which they crewed with, according to the Beach Patrol and Corsair Fleet by Dennis L. Noble, college boys, adventurous lads of shore villages, boy scouts, beachcombers, ex-bootleggers, and rum runners. According to a 1941 article in Popular Science, these men would be greenhorns aboard a battle wagon, but along the line of their own hobby, many of them are extremely good, and so are their boats. In terms of actual combat, however, the Corsair Fleet wasn't going in guns blazing, ripping submarine hulls open to the Atlantic Ocean. In fact, they had only one possible submarine kill when CJR 4436 dropped a depth charge on a position smoke bombed by a Civil Air Patrol flight. A column of oil was the only evidence that suggested they had hit the sub. On another occasion, on the 15th of September 1942, the sailboat Edlu II spotted a U-boat less than 100 yards ahead and, armed with only machine guns, charged the enemy vessel. Uncertain what sort of threat Edlu II posed, the Germans dived and fled. Lacking engines, the sailing vessels of the Corsair Fleet were sometimes able to go undetected by German sonar, allowing them to get closer to the U-boats and get a more accurate read on their position. According to Coast Guard historian C.K. Larson, the large 50 to 100-foot sailboats were the signature vessels of the CPF. They became important assets for the anti-submarine patrol as they could hear submarines more easily than motorboats and the Germans could not hear them. Just having the Corsair fleet in the water was a deterrent for the Germans, whose presence off the East Coast declined throughout 1942, many redirected to the ongoing Battle of the Atlantic. According to Larson, by mid-September of 1942, 480 CPF vessels were working along the Atlantic and Gulf coasts out of more than 30 bases. By December, nationwide, there were 2,093 responsible for recording sightings, unidentified sounds, and significant flotsam and jetsam. Perhaps more important than spotting enemy activity, the Corsair fleet conducted rescue operations and retrieved lost cargo too. According to an official Coast Guard document, time after time, these Coast Guard auxiliaries took their vulnerable small craft, a few armed with only a rifle or a shotgun, others with boat hooks and flashlights, to haul drowning, burned, oil-covered merchant seamen from the peril of the sea. And in the words of author Joseph P. Freitas, more than 500 merchant seamen were rescued during the early phase of the Battle of the Atlantic. On the morning of the 13th of August 1942, for instance, U-171 surfaced on the Gulf and blew the steam tanker R.M. Parker Jr. open with a pair of torpedoes. The fishing yawl, designated CGRT-2267, or the Pioneer, got onto the scene right away, rescuing every single one of the tanker's crewmen. In January 1943, Admiral King cut the Corsair fleet down by 35% due to the rapid decline of the German U-boat threat. By October, the fleet was disbanded. We'll end another quote from Freitas. To many military personnel, sailboats against the technologically advanced German submarines seemed ridiculous, but history shows how successful it actually was. We'd love to know what you think though. Had you heard of the Corsair fleet before today? Do you know anything about the fleet that we didn't cover in this video? What about some more specific stories about what these brave civilians got up to during the war? Please feel free to share your thoughts in the comments section below. And as always guys, thank you so much for watching, and I hope you learned something new.